peace in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, dear viewers. I hope that your time and the Lord are working well in this pandemic. I hope that you are enjoying the presence of the Lord. Today is another day, this is another week, and it's like the end of the week, maybe on Sunday. And I hope that your week has started well in the Lord. Today being the 59th of 100 days of prayer, we will be focusing on a topic which is interesting. Mourning has broken. So if you are joining us for the first time, we have been having 100 days of prayer since 1927 when the world church started joining together in prayer, in the second social prayer for our country, for those who are affected by COVID-19, and also for the infilling or outpouring of the Holy Spirit as we near the close of provision or the close of the world. Therefore, I would like to welcome you and you join us throughout this week so that we can continue worshiping the Lord and we can continue presenting our request unto Him. And I believe at the end of it all, He will hear our prayers and He will answer us. Today, as I have said, we are discussing about mourning has broken. Mourning has broken. Shall we have our prayer before we read the word of God? Shall we pray? Our kind and merciful Father in heaven, we thank you and glorify your name for the day that you have given unto us. Today is day 59 of 100 days of prayer. And Jehovah God, we have experienced you through our lives. We are thankful and worthy to come before thy presence. So we thank you for the mercies that you have bestowed upon our lives, that even though we are the way we are, you are ready to do that. You are ready to cleanse us. You are ready to create new hearts in our lives. Today, as we read thy scriptures, we invoke thy presence to bind with us, so that Jehovah God, you interpret the one in accordance to thy will. And Jehovah God, I say that you be thy viewer, with him or her before thy presence, that also as we participate in this, that we may hear his prayers or our prayers, and also that we may enable him to come closer to thee. In Jesus' name we pray and be happy. Our key text today is from the book of Matthew, Matthew 5, verse 4. And I would request you to take your Bibles and open them. I have New King James Version, and I hope that you will follow through your version. Matthew 5, verse 4. Remember, we started on the Beatitude yesterday, and today this is the second Beatitude. Yesterday we saw that the blessed are the poor in spirit, and we saw what it means to have a blessed poverty. What does it mean, blessed poverty? Today we read 5 verse 4. The Bible says, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Present, let me ask a very simple question. How many of us love mourning? I believe we don't love mourning. And mourning is grieving or having sorrow or because someone has left us or have died. And I couldn't understand what is the real meaning of mourning until I went to conduct a service in the Nyanza place, those side of Nyanza. And that's when I understood what mourning means. Because we used to hear that there are people who are even hired to come and mourn when someone dies. And even I've heard a lot of myths. I don't know whether it's myths or reality. There are people who choose, there are people who will come to mourn when they die. They're weird perspectives, but I know that there is no one who likes to die, and there is no one who loves to mourn. But Mourning, you will understand it when you go that those sides. When someone dies, they will mourn heartily. And I heard and witnessed that even some people are hired. I don't know whether it's true or false, but they are hired to come and cry and cry and cry. And even if someone was not so good, people mourn, the people cry. Even if someone was disturbing the community, still you will see people coming and mourning. Even if someone was a drunkard, not concerned about the family members, people will mourn. People will have sorrow for that person. And I've ever witnessed people writing tributes to people who have died, and they speak of good things that that person had done. But I remember one case, one tribute that I read, and Ayoroji also was stating the same, of a young boy who died, and what was written in the those programs shocked me, because they wrote that this person was brought up by parents who are poor. They insisted of him going to school, but he refused to go to school. He was stealing, and he died. He was beaten, or he was killed by mob justice. And we saw this recently when a mother who has born a child, did not even have a tear in Kayole. She did not have even a single tear when her son was killed. Actually, she was saying, let it be this way, because it will be a teaching to the young people who engage themselves in this kind of zakari. So she did not mourn. It's funny, but you know, there is going to mourn if your beloved person, the breadwinner of your family, your dad or your mom, who you love so much, your child who you cherish so much, died. I think you mourn. There is a real mourning, not the mourning when you are hired to mourn for someone who has died. You have no relationship. Not in the mourning that you die because of your friend, but a real mourning where someone who is very dear to your heart dies. I think you can have a real mourning. But today, we are not speaking about this kind of sorrow or this kind of mourning. I would like to take you through this. The mourning here that we are speaking about is brought to view in true heart sorrow for sin. And as one is drawn to behold Jesus afflicted on the cross, he discerns the sinfulness of humanity. This is what the sorrow that we want to speak about today. The sorrow that comes from the reality, that from your heart seeing the reality of why Jesus died. The sorrow that comes with the reality of Jesus Christ dying because of your sin and of my sin. This kind of sorrow is what I want us to speak about. And when you realize this, when you realize that Jesus died, and when you look at the cross, you hear that Jesus has died because of you, there is that deep sorrow that comes from within, because you have realized that you are the one who have sinned. Remember this song that was sung very beautifully, I saw Jesus hung on the cross, and I asked, who has crucified my Savior? And the one whom I asked, he said that you are the one. Nilikuwa kwenye haraiki, Yesu ino alipokufa, you know. And the song goes on saying that I'm the one who took the hammer and not Jesus on the cross. Why? Because of my sinfulness. And you can realize how painful it is if you realize that you are the one who have killed someone without knowing, or you realize that you continue to kill someone or to inflict pain in that person when you sin. The kind of sorrow that I want you to get into is this kind of sorrow. And this kind of person sees that it is sin which scourged and crucified the Lord of glory. He sees that while he has been loved with unspeakable tenderness, his life has been a continuous sense of ingratitude and rebellion.
He has forsaken his best friend and abused heaven's most precious gift. Remember, Jesus is our best friend. He is a friend who is closer than a brother. I know we have a bad relationship with our brothers. We have bad relationship with our sisters. I don't want to speak more about sisters because sometimes sisters are married and they forget even the other family. But a brother whom you share a compound, like traditionally, you know that when you are two brothers, there is somewhere you should build a simba and or you should have a house in your home. Even if you have bought a land in Nairobi or somewhere else, there is a simba or a special house that you should build in your home so that when you go to visit, you go and reside there. So you have a mutual relationship and responsibilities of home. They lie on your hand and you are the one to take care of them. So a brother is someone who is supposed to be very close. But here, Jesus is a friend who is closer than a brother. He died for you. He is a precious gift from heaven. You know, he has crucified to himself the Son of God, afresh and pierced anew that bleeding and stricken heart. God gave Jesus to come and die for you. He gave Jesus to come and die for me. That is something that should move us. He is separated from God by a gulf. Jesus was separated. We are separated from God by a gulf of sin that is broad and black and deep. And Jesus himself is the one who came to do this, to bridge the gap. And the mourning that should come from us is from the brokenness of our heart, by knowing that even after the separation of God, from God, Jesus came to bring back the relationship between us and God. Such mourning shall be comforted. This is the mourning that we are speaking about in the book of Matthew 5, verse 4. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. If you are brokenhearted because you have seen the state of your heart, the sinfulness of your heart, Jesus will come. I have come and have died for you, and you are still continuing to rebel, and you realize that you are still sinning, and now you feel that you are inadequate, and you feel that no, you have done something which is very bad, and now you feel guilty, you feel sorrow. That is the kind of mourning that we are speaking about. And until we feel or we get into our hearts that is the kind of life that we are living in, that's when the Holy Spirit will come to comfort. God reveals to us our guilt that we may flee to Christ, and through him be set free from the bondage of sin and rejoice in the liberty of the sons of God. Let me tell you, God is calling unto you to come to him so that we can enjoy the fruits of our mourning. When you realize that it is true, you have done something which is not right. Like David, he realized that he did bad by taking Bathsheba and killing the husband. He went before the throne of God. He went with deep sorrow. He did not sleep for days. He cried for forgiveness. And God came and comforted his heart. In true contrition, we may come to the foot of the cross and there leave our burdens. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. If we feel that we are not part and parcel with Christ, that we have forsaken Christ, that we have made him to agonize and to remember the pain that he went through in the at the cross, let us go to him and ask for forgiveness. Today, I want you to ask yourself this question. Have you ever taken time to fully realize what Jesus accomplished for you in the darkest hours of his dying? Remember, this week we are dealing with heart searching, a time for heart searching. Have you ever sat down and thought of the condition that Jesus was in, the situation that he found himself in, the pain that he felt? Have you ever sat down and thought about that? As you behold the afflicted, crucified, sin-bearing Savior, the question that I want to ask you today is, will you let those sins penetrate your heart? As you internalize this agony of experiencing the second death in your faith, the new lenses open your eyes to see the fullness of your favorite sins? Why not today start mourning for your sins, especially for those which have been unwilling to give up? There are things that you are not willing to give up. There are things that you are still clinging on. Even if you have proclaimed yourself as a Christian, even if you have proclaimed yourself as a born-again Christian, there are those things which you have not let go. Maybe it is gossip. Maybe it's fornication, adultery. Maybe it is jealousy. Maybe it is lies. Agonize for those things. Mourn for those things. And go trust. Confess them to Jesus. He will gradually forgive you. He will comfort you. And he will give you victory. And that is my prayer to you. Today, come to Jesus. As we pray, I would like to commit yourself to Christ. And pray for clearer understanding of what really happened at the cross. Because that is why many of us, we don't submit ourselves to Christ. Because we don't realize the magnitude of what happened at the cross. The moment we will realize that Jesus died, he cried in pain, and he died for you and for me, I think and I know you will not be the same again. Take time to think about that. Pray for God to help you. Hate sin and love righteousness. God loves you, but he hates the sin in you. May God help you to hate those things as he has hated the things. And may he help you to like his righteousness. And when you do that, I know that he will be very happy and he will be with you. Shall we have a word of prayer as we terminate this session? And I pray that you may continue. We have been praying for you and we have been receiving your prayer request, some of you, but we to urge and pray that we continue sending those prayer reports. We continue praying with you, continue to share these messages so that others can be blessed. And I pray that may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you, and may the Lord shine his face upon you. And most of all, may he prepare you for his second coming. We shall pray. Our kind and loving Master in heaven, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Jehovah God, for the message that you have given unto us, that we should mourn for our sins. We should mourn for what we have done, which is not in accordance with thy will. And this morning should come with an understanding of what you did at Calvary, Jesus Christ. The agony you went through and the pain that you feel each and every day as we sin as human beings. We neglect the great salvation that you provided for us. Jehovah God, we pray that may your Holy Spirit reign in our hearts and may he enable us to think about the cross and to think about the acts that you did. It is out of love that you did it. We should reciprocate this by loving you and hating you. And we pray for an understanding of what happened. And we pray for an urge to be in our hearts, an urge of righteousness. So that in whatever we do, we will do it in accordance with the will of God. Jehovah God, we have fixed ourselves unto you. I pray for my dear viewer. I pray for his family, or her family. I remember. I pray for this country. I pray for the whole world. I pray for the leadership of the church, the leadership of the world and of the country, and especially at this time, we are faced with a pandemic which has shaken the world. Father, we have fixed each and every member of your community, of the community of believers into thy word. Those who are sick, remember them, heal them, because you are grateful. Those who are suffering because they have lost their jobs, because they have lost their livelihood, remember them in a special way and provide for them. Give and gold belongs to you. Provide for our country so that they can be able to put even more pressure so that they can curb the spread of this. Help us as civilians to adhere with the rules and regulations that have been put across to the Jehovah God. At the, every, after the end of it all, we will say that indeed you have been with us and we have been victorious. Because each one of us participated in seeing that we have carved this thread of it. Thank you for listening unto us. And thank you for listening even to the prayers of your servants and saints from all over the world. Father, we pray and we continue to pray with you. May you continue acting unto our prayers. Thank you for answering our prayers, because we have prayed each, believing and trusting that sweet and wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Thank you for joining us. God bless you. Thank you.